I was pointed out during the last video that I was remiss in introducing the beer. So, today we have Roundabout English Dark Mild Ale from Torque Brewing in Winnipeg. They describe it as reserved, nutty, bespoke, and malt forward. Pairs well with Windy Walks and Minding the Gap. Pretty much all of their beers have some sort of an automotive theme or pun or something to the naming, and this one is no exception. Today, I'm going to take a look at this package that was sent to me from Universal Solder in, where are they? Windsor, Ontario. It's a small mom-and-pop kit company in Canada. They used to be in Yorkton, Saskatchewan. That's where the company was founded. But in the last year or so, they've moved to Ontario. He said he was going to send me a few things. That's definitely a few things. Wow, looks like I'm going to be able to do a kit build every couple of months and still not run out before December. Cool. Let's see what these all are. These are going to be a little bit hard to see without opening the bags. I don't really want to open them right now. But he did handily write the product numbers on the back of them. So let's start going through these. A touch sensor light switch with on-off delay. 0 to 60 second soldering kit. There's a quick schematic, fairly straightforward by the looks of it. Okay, so there's a touch sensor on the board, but you can also add an external sensor, runs off 5 volts. Neat. Next, what is this one? Looks like it's got a coaxial jack and a couple of chips. 26855. Burglar Alarm with Time Delay 555 DIY soldering kit. So far, these are both quite affordable kits. And there's a quick schematic there for like a bedroom door or something. This is a straightforward enough kit that a teenager who is starting to get interested in electronics would probably be able to throw it together pretty easily. And this one looks like it mounts on a breadboard, or maybe it's one of those breadboard power supply things. 26886. Oh, I saw some of these in the package too. Permanent breadboards, okay. But this is the one that that I was looking at. Power supply USB UART module for CANADUINO permanent breadboards. I see it's intended to mount on these permanent breadboard things and just solder it down. So you've got a ready-to-go power supply. That's neat. Input voltage 5 volts, output 5 volts, and 3.3 volts. And it's got a CH340 on it for USB programming. Interesting. So you can also have a microcontroller on the board that doesn't have USB, and this will just create it for you. Cool.
Oh yeah, he did send an assortment of these little permanent proto boards too. But yeah, there's how they're laid out. The same as just a standard solder with breadboard. So there's 6 pins going that way that are all tied together, and then 6 that way and all the way across. And then there are 2 power buses down each side that are all tied together. So if you've built up a circuit on a breadboard, you can just transfer it directly to one of these and make it permanent. One thing I like about Universal Solder's kits, he uses very, very thick circuit board material. This is solid stuff, so it's not the normal cheap stuff that you get from, you know, the usual suspects in China. Similar to that is this other one that looks very, very much like it. It's... But this one's got pins for going onto a solderless breadboard rather than mounting onto a permanent one.
And yeah, there it is. CANADUINO breadboard power supply module, 3.3 volts, 5 volts, 12 volts. And again, with USB TTL UART. There's plenty of companies that make the power supply boards that physically look like this, that do 3 volts, 3.3 and 5 volts. I haven't seen one that does 12 volts, and I certainly haven't seen anybody else that does it with the... USB to TTL adapter in it. Again, it's using the CH340, which is the USB to serial chip that's on the vast majority of the generic Arduino cone boards. This is a very, very cool little board.
This one, number 26857, it's in a clear package so we can actually see what's going on. It calls itself a pulse generator with adjustable frequency and duty cycle.
Pulse generator, adjustable pulse width, 1 hertz to 1.5 megahertz, DIY soldering kit with 555. Yeah, this is a modification of a fairly standard 555 circuit, but he's got switchable capacitors, 2 adjustable resistors to allow you to get that massive range of frequencies. It seems like just a good little kit for somebody that's starting out in this hobby and wants to get their feet wet with soldering, wants to learn how different circuits work, and a classic like the 555 has so many different applications. It's It's just a good thing to play with and learn and experiment with.
Let's see what else we got here in these small things. Can I see what it says? Oh, it's a logic level indicator.
10-bit breadboard logic level indicator, 3.3 volt to 5 volt, cascadable. These aren't kits exactly. You do have to solder the pins on, but they're mostly just, you know, glue to put together other circuit pieces. Oh, that's what he means by cascadable. You can run the line voltages across between the two of them. Well, that's clever. So logic level indicator, it has 10 high active channels, high impedance input. If you're troubleshooting a project, or if you just want to monitor what's happening as you're designing a project, rather than putting just a bunch of LEDs down, because those may load down your circuit, taking whatever current out, this thing seems to just isolate it.
Now, what is this little guy? Can't really tell through the bag. So we'll just do what we always do. 26885.
High precision 1 hertz clock generator. 3.8 parts per million and also 1024 hertz output. Looks like it's crystal based. At least I think that's a crystal there. Okay, so if you were doing a clock circuit or something like that, you could use this as a timing source and be within 2 minutes a year. That's pretty good.
Now we're starting to get into the bigger ones. This one, it's actually got printed instructions in the bag. There it is right there, 26860. What are you?
Electronic Education and Troubleshooting Project, the Broken Code Lock DIY Kit. Well, that sounds interesting. So this one is actually intended to both be a soldering practice kit, but also a circuit analysis practice kit, to try and figure out what's going on inside it. And I guess that explains why it's using a discrete power supply section rather than just using a module. I like that approach. Well done, man.
We got three more left. This one's got a whole bunch of relays in it. I2C relay shield for Arduino. So it's decoding I2C on probably that surface mount. Oh, there are a few chips that are already populated on the board. The surface mount's already done. So all that's left for the tinkerer to do is add all the through-hole components. Again, introductory level soldering kit.
CANADUINO 8-channel stackable I2C relay shield kit for Arduino. So there, as you can see, it just stacks right on top of a standard Arduino Uno, or a Mega, actually. They have the same pinout for the basic pins. And then it gives you 8 relays. Oh yeah, and being I2C, you can just keep stacking them to give you more and more relays. Sure, why not? There is a set of dip switches over there that allows you to choose your addressing. That should give you lots of addresses to stack these puppies up, just like he shows there. That is fun.
Next in is 26789, which has a whole ton of parts, including, intriguingly, some heat sinks and some really big capacitors.
Stereo TDA 2030 Audio Amplifier DIY Soldering Kit with Tone Control. That looks like a fairly involved little circuit. And like any good stereo amplifier, it essentially just is two copies of the same circuit on the same board. The only reference between them is power and ground. Now, it runs on 12 to 30 volts, has bass and treble controls, which we saw, 3.5 millimeter input. So you can connect it to just about anything except, of course, a modern cell phone. Don't get me started. So it's 15 watts per channel in 4-ohm modes.
And the last kit in is the largest because, you know, that's how I do things. And it also came with a set of accessories, although they are normally sold extra. What is this guy, number 26888? In the bag, I can see a whole bunch of LEDs, like a whole bunch. And it is a good-sized circuit board. And the accessory bag has a USB power cable, a couple of extra transistors, maybe not extra, but, and an Arduino Nano. Huh.
LED clock DIY kit with melody alarm option for Arduino Nano V3. Oh, wow. That is a cool-looking kit. There's all the bits and pieces. Looks like it comes with a small circuit board, as well as the main circuit board. And presumably all those LEDs are multiplexed. That would make sense that they were. It's even got a photoresistor so that it can do dark light dimming, I guess. As with a lot of his other kits, he's provided some demo code for it. That's cool. Oh, you can also add on extra melody chips if you want. You can add on an atomic clock as a reference if you want. All your usual clock functions that you'd expect. Automatic display dimming. Yeah, I thought that. I kind of saw that. Different alarms, alarm snoozes. Okay, so the Melody chip is an option, and I'm assuming that's one of the things that's in that accessory bag that he sent me. Oh, that's the transistor-looking things that that were in that accessory bag. Okay. Oh, well, that's cool. This one I think I'm going to leave for later in the year because it looks like a fairly involved kit, but it also really looks like a fun kit, and I want to be able to take my time with it. I want to do it some week when I've got lots of time to devote to this project.
I don't really think I'm going to build a kit tonight, but I think maybe we'll take a look at, where is the other one? No, not that one, not that one. Oh, there it is. I'm going to pop out these two breadboard power supplies and take a closer look at them, because those intrigue me. So there they are. They're a little bit different size and form factor, but they're a similar function, but they are intended to serve slightly different needs. This one, again, is designed to go onto one of those permanent perma-proto boards and just be a permanent power supply for it, and bolt holes that match up with the holes that are in it, plus and minus voltage there and there. And you can strap either side for 3 volts or 5 volts, 3.3 or 5, on those two pins, so you can have different voltages on the different buses. It does use a USB-C connector for its power input, but I don't think it does power delivery. That wasn't mentioned in the listing, but again, that doesn't really matter because we're only putting out 5 volts and 3.3. We're not putting out higher voltages. Not really surprising that the 3.3 volts comes courtesy of a 1117 3.3 linear regulator. That's very common with this kind of board. And the 5 volts, of course, comes natively off the USB. There's LED indicators to show the presence of the 3.3 and 5 volts. It's hard to read, but that is the CH340 that does the USB to UART serial conversion. And there are the serial connections broken out. DTR, which is usually used as a reset, TX and RX, 3.3 volts. And or 5 volts, whatever you need. And again, that's intended to pair with these boards, and you just bolt them on there with the same mounting holes, and the pins, and just drop a piece of wire down through there and solder it on there and solder it on there, and that gets your voltage onto the buses of your circuit. That's a pretty slick little solution, and I haven't seen exactly that combination of things anywhere else. And then there's this other one, which is designed to go onto a solderless breadboard and power that up. It just goes on like that, and again, supplies the power to the rails on both sides. The major difference being we have switches to pick 3.3, 5, or 12 volts. And there is the connections for the UART, the serial connection again. But this one also, in addition to having 3.3 and 5 volts, it also has 12 volts, and it has LEDs on all the signal lines and the power lines to indicate their presence. That's very nice, just for quick troubleshooting, just to make sure that everything's happy. But on the other side of the board, we have some differences. Similar to the first board that we looked at, there is a CH340 again. But instead of having a linear voltage regulator, we have what appears to be switching regulators. So the two switching regulator chips, or at least I'm assuming that's what they are an L2E on this side. B21G3H, I think, on this side. I spent a fair bit of time in Google, and of course I couldn't find either of them, but it's pretty obvious just from the way they're connected and the big inductor there and a handful of diodes around them that those are... One will be set up as a buck and one will be set up as a boost converter to create the 3.3 and 12 volts that this thing is putting out. Those two are pretty neat and both have a lot of functionality that the more typical breadboard power supplies don't have. These ones all do the job for 3.3 or 5 volts. They all use the 1117 regulator. This one, just for my own peace of mind, I've replaced the... little jumpers with PTC fuses, reset auto self-resetting fuses, just to protect myself from being stupid on there. But that's not absolutely necessary, but that's what I've done on that one. But those, like I said, those all serve the same function, but these two both have the UART chip on there to allow you to get serial programming into any board that you have plugged in with them, or any microcontroller or whatever. So that is a feature I've never seen on any other one. And this one has three voltages rather than the two that all the other ones have. So that is very, very cool. Those are going to be handy in the future, I'm pretty sure. I think I can probably retire these ones. But that aside, I'm going to start building through these kits sort of like I said, every month or two, probably, until I run through them all. I'll have links to the whole bunch of them down below. Comment in the comments which ones you want to see me do first, which one you don't want to see me do at all, if any. Have you built any of these yourself? What's your experience with them? I have built a few of his kits in the past, and they've always gone together very well. And as I pointed out, they've always got this extra thick, extra heavy duty board material with it's just very well manufactured stuff. And this may sound like an ad, but he's not paying me. He did give me this stuff, but he's not paying me. The links down below are not going to be affiliate links. I don't get any kickbacks or anything else if you guys buy these things or not. I just think they're cool kits. But yeah, leave me a comment down below. Let me know which one you want me to see me build first, and I'll do that probably sometime next month. Thanks for watching, as always. I do appreciate it. I will talk to you later.